Hello and welcome. Today you will learn why we need to include a social sustainable development if we want to make livable cities. The first steps towards a sustainable development was the awareness of our relation with nature. Henry Theroux was one of the first to sketch a romantic view on this relation between man and nature in his book Walden, or Life in the Woods. This was 1854. A century followed where nature preservation became more and more important. Followed from the 60s of the last century by the environmental movement against pollution, the decreasing of biodiversity, and the use of ending resources. The Club of Rome put out the following warning in 1972. We broke into nature's safe deposit box of fossil carbon, turning it into a wider range of fuels and potentially destabilizing the global climate in the process. The awareness of some was vital, yet it didn't change the world for the better. To do this, a new perspective was needed. We had to wait until 1992 at the Rio Earth Summit. The central conclusion of this summit was that human beings are at the center of concerns for sustainable development. They are entitled to a healthy and productive life in harmony with nature. So the ecological awareness first shifted towards an environmental awareness, and now people were included. The involvement of the layman, the well-being of the end users became central themes. People were part of the problem, but they are also the reason to find solutions, and they are the solutions. Let's watch 12-year-old Severin Suzuki at a conference in 1992.
You don't know how to fix the holes in our ozone layer. You don't know how to bring the salmon back up a dead stream. You don't know how to bring back an animal now extinct. And you can't bring back the forest that once grew where there is now a desert. If you don't know how to fix it, please stop breaking it. Here, you may be delegates of your government, business people, organizers, reporters, or politicians, but really, your mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, aunts and uncles, and all of you are someone's child.
If we start with the well-being of people, we take the perspective of the World Health Organization. In a livable city, we fulfilling basic needs of all and emphasizing the needs of the vulnerable groups. Basic needs are health and safety, being free from war and hunger. Linked topic is happiness. Emphasizing the needs of vulnerable groups is paying attention to children, elderly, the urban poor, disabled, etc. A child-friendly city is friendly for all. A city where wayfinding is based on the capacity of all people is more accessible for all. Environmental awareness of citizen is one step. Participation and co-shaping the sustainable city is another step. Of course, also the sustainability awareness and participation of other actors are vital here, like governments, designers, and all actors involved in shaping and maintaining the city. The definition of Brundtland speaks of the needs of future generations. This includes two questions. First, to what extent are people willing to adjust their behavior to what is best for people over 20 to 50 years? Most people cannot oversee the impact of their behavior of today on their well-being tomorrow. During the first traffic jam in the Netherlands in 1955, people were filled with joy over seeing so many luxury, more cars, are only better. Secondly, what are the needs of the next generation? This is why we emphasize basic needs, the common ground between this and next generations, and between people here and people elsewhere. So livability is not about owning a car, but then what? To answer this question, we combine two perspectives on people-environment interaction. The first starts from the individual. What is his or her perception of the environment? Be aware, in this case, the environment consists of the city and its artifacts, the natural environment, including our climate, and the social environment. The last one is the most important for a city dweller. This so-called perceived livability is very determined by personal factors: age, capacities, salary, self-esteem, etc. It is vital to research the perceived livability, but it gives very limited handles to create a livable city. In the second perspective, we start with the environment, in our case, the city. So what may facilitate the well-being of the individual? We call this the presumed livability. We presume people like to go where other people are. We know people appreciate green and water in the living environment, and we know there are many environmental factors that can lead to stress. Stress may come from other people, from the physical environment, like from pollution, noise, but also from a poorly designed urban fabric. If we look at livability from a sustainable development perspective, we focus on the match between a person and his or her environment. We look what the optimal conditions are for the species, called human, to survive. We call this sustainable livability. Let us now look at the urban environment. A sustainable urban environment facilitates the following primary needs for all individuals, for this and for coming generations: health, safety, control over one's own life, a social environment, so-called quality of interaction, and contact with the natural environment. These needs in the urban environment are different from other needs, like, for example, material prosperity. The last one is not explicitly related to the city, but vary per person, country, and depend on the world economy. To wrap up, a city that's loved by its inhabitants is a city that facilitates the needs of her inhabitants. Two sides of the same coin. The urban environment contributes to the well-being of people, and the very same people will maintain the city. So if you are out there, be aware to what extent your urban environment facilitates the needs for all. Is it safe? Is it healthy? Do you have any control over it? Can you interact with others? And is the natural environment present? Your awareness of these needs contributes to a sustainable and livable city.